excited about our topic because I know you're going to be sharing some of your wisdom on how women can filter for the unique right man.
Yes.
And I wonder if you could begin by just sharing with us from your experience and observation and work that you've done in the world, what are some of the common errors women make when they seek a man?
Oh, you don't know how much I love this question. I love this question because once you get it, it changes everything. So, speaking of ups and downs, you know, I got into this, and I was a writer, obviously, and an academic, and I was doing films and raising my little family. And then suddenly I was single at 39, unexpectedly. And it was wonderful in its way now, 14 years later. I'm actually having lunch with my ex-wife tomorrow. We've become really good friends after a long period of disentanglement. But I had no idea how to date. I didn't know how to do this, and I felt just so betrayed and so bad about myself, and I felt like my whole identity was gone because my whole life was my children and my family. And suddenly, yeah, my kids were in my house, you know, and that was, you know, the first night I wasn't with my sons, literally I spread their photos all over the dining room table and just wept
oh,
for hours. Yeah, well, it's okay, you know, it was really rough on me. The frame I had, and we can talk about setting frames, about how you frame knowledge or, you know, data, how you frame it makes all difference. The frame I had was that I had, quote unquote, lost my family. When in
right,
fact, what I had gained was the opportunity to form a relationship with them as me instead of as us, you know, and it's different and it gave me a lot more freedom. So that's why I never say, you'll never hear me say I got divorced at 39. I would say I got single. That's my frame. My frame was, oh, new opportunity to create my life. And even though it hurt, you know, the frame wasn't, oh, I'm a divorced man. My frame was, I am now a single man. I've got to figure this stuff out. And I had no idea how to date anybody. I had been married since I was 23. I was very loyal. My family was my life. You know, and even when I was teaching little 18-year-old admiring, you know, college freshmen, because I taught poetry, and they would come in very type A Stanford girls and, you know, working hard all their lives, and then they'd bat their eyes at me, oh, you're someone who's emotional, you know, because I would challenge them to, like, what were you passionate about? Same issue, by the way, Michelle, what inspires you, right? I said,
right,
I bore easily. Don't give me boring essays. I want you to write from your heart, you know? And so I had no idea how to date, didn't flirt, didn't do any of that, and I didn't know what to do, but I do know how to write. So when I found out about online dating, I'm like, ooh, this is kind of a magical gift from the universe. I can actually write to women and see what they have to say. And so I went online, and that was a life changer for me because, you know, I have zero interest in going to some bar and meeting some random person. I want to know, you know, what inspires you? What do you read? What means something to you? And if you write a profile that's directed toward the right man, you will meet the right man. And if you write a junky profile or a general profile, or one of the things to talk about is, you know, talking about characteristics of men rather than character, which is what you actually want. We can talk about that, and we have to talk about that. Then you can actually attract exactly the person you want. But you have to put in that little bit of effort to articulate what's genuinely important to you for how you want to feel in relationship, and not talk about little black dresses and Thai food and playing tennis, because that doesn't mean anything to the end. So big lesson
right,
number one.
So Adam, if I can just emphasize something you said there, because I think it's so key. So part of what you're talking about is one key is that a woman needs to have that clarity about what she really wants and needs and what her desires are. And then she has to be able to express that and articulate that in a way that a man can understand it and respond to it. And I know this is an area where you have a lot of expertise. So I'm just emphasizing this, and I really love the emphasis that you give on a man's character as opposed to just focusing on characteristics, because I think that's a big trap, don't you?
Oh, it's the biggest trap. Online especially. Like this morning, I helped a woman with her profile. She was recommended to me by a mutual friend of ours, and she was attracting all the wrong men. And for that exact reason, she hadn't really prioritize the character of the man she wanted. I asked her, I said, what do you like in a man? She goes, you mean like how tall he is? Like, no, screw how tall he is. Like, do you like a man who's very honest, who's very vulnerable, who's a leader in his community? And so, the, you know, lesson number one, focus on character. Lesson number two, when you communicate that, whether online or in person, you couch it in terms of admiration. So men generally, and again, one thing I don't like is when they say all men or all women, because it's not true. But men generally will process the feeling of being loved by you, or they'll love you through the lens of admiration and appreciation. So you can say to a guy, and women have said it to me on dates, I love you, like early on. And you look at them and you go, okay, whatever. But if they say, I admire you, oh, really? Tell me more. Like, what do you admire me about? You know, like that's how we process love. Because we need a good man needs to feel of service. He's got to feel like he's doing something for you. Right. And I have lots of ways of, if you like somebody, to give them ways to have small victories with you. All right. So in my book, The Right Man Online, for example, I talk a lot about victories for men. It's a very male language. If you can hit those 13 victories that men look for in women initially, then you'll have his attention. If you can't feel like a victory in his life, why would he bother? Right? He's got lots of choice. Mm-hmm. We all have lots of choice now. So one thing I teach women is to speak in the language of victory. And I teach men to speak in the language of safety and cherishment. So normally, right, you go online. And what do? You write a resume. Who cares, right? Like, I'm from here. I lived in this city. Blah, 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 blah. Where's your heart? I can't feel it. But worse, you don't speak in the language of the gender you're speaking to. So men will get on and do what men do, which is try to establish some kind of status, right? Because that's how men operate with each other. It's our natural language because evolutionarily and historically, if you didn't have social status, you don't have access to resources, and then you can't have a family, et cetera. So men will go on and create status. I've been to 27 countries. I like to scuba dive. I'm a lawyer. Okay, that's all very nice, but it leaves women cold. So I teach men how to take their information and now put it in a language of cherishment, of creating safety, and of conveying the kind of character that women really look for. So that's what I do for men. For women, women's profiles all sound like this to men. Are you ready? Mm-hmm. They all sound like, I love my family. I love my friends. Here's a picture of my cat, right? That's what women's profiles sound like to men. And it just leaves them cold. What women are trying to say, and they are saying it in the language of women, they're saying, my life is built around love. My whole being is built around the beings in my life, my family, my friends, my pets. I live to love. Now, if you could take that same information and put it in the language that men respond to, that it makes that they scratch their head and go, wow, here's the key line. My life would be better with this person in it. Then you're getting somewhere. So the lesson is to take what you want to say, but couch it in the language of your audience, of the gender you're actually writing to. And I have lots of ways of doing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, fun, and it's not something that really a lot of people know intuitively. I mean, you look at you and I have both spent time helping people with their online profiles, and you look at the profiles out there, and it's like, it's so painful sometimes, because you know these are very lovely people, but they're not speaking in a language that is likely to draw in the right person for them.
Right. And dating, in some ways, without being crass, is marketing. I mean, you have to communicate something to the person. Marketing is you communicate to get a response, right? And dating is the same way. You have to communicate something to the person you want to have a response to what you're saying. So how you say it is very, very important. And understanding their reality is very important. And I teach men the same thing, by the way, right? Two-way street.
I think the women on the call are very happy to hear that, because I think that women sometimes feel like we're the ones that are required to figure all of this out and take all of the effort and all of the steps, right?
Well, I think women do feel that. And one of the things that I always remind women, because I work with so many tens of thousands of men, and I do, by the way, I do singles events, weekends, immersions with men and women, where they learn how to connect in deep ways, so they have fun together, but also learn how to communicate what's inspiring about them. So I work with men, And women are like, but men seem to have it all figured out. They don't. They are floundering just as well. They just hide it better. You know, they just end up, you know, men are better with solitude generally than women are. Doesn't mean they're happy. It means they can handle it better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're lonely, and they're really lonely. They're really lonely. I know so many great men. The men who come to my live events, my singles weekends, are the sweetest men in the world. They really are. And they also just have not learned how to communicate their heart, you know, because they've been listening to dumb pickup stuff or cultural stuff that says you have to do this and act, you know, act like you've got it all handled. You know, no, you need to get your life handled, but you actually have this beautiful heart that they've been taught they can't show. So the good news is there actually are wonderful men out there. You have to look past the surface and you have to call them. I call it conjuring up out of the ethers. You know, if you use the right language and you learn the language of finding the right man for you because you've articulated it so well, it's like magic, you know? It's like putting a spell out into the world and the right people start appearing. And it's true. You can do that. I did it.
And this comes back to what you said at the beginning of the conversation about inspiring a relationship.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so let me, I can talk about that for a second if you want.
Sure.
So a lot of people say, how do I find the right guy? I'm like, well, that's not the right question, first of all. The question is, how do you become so awesome and so radiant and loving your life so much and so clear in what you want that the right guy is going to see you or connect with you and go, wow, I've been wanting to be with this person all my life. So, you know, everyone on this call is smart enough to know that the process is, you know, self-refinement so that you're the best possible partner. That's why you're on this call. That's why they work with you, because we refine ourselves. I mean, I just said to you before this call, before we got on, I was recently got engaged, and I was saying to a friend of mine today, I know, right? And I was saying to a friend of mine,
So thrilled for you, Adam, and we're all, I know all of the women are cheering. Well, maybe some of them are a little sad. Like I told you, I did have quite a few women ask me if you were single, so we might have a few tears and a lot of cheers.
Hopefully not too many. But here's the thing, I actually said to him, how she makes me feel, and it's everything I've written, and I didn't make this up, you know, it works. I said, she makes me feel so loved. It taxes my self-esteem upper limit, you know? And I think, like, she loves me so much. Sometimes I go, God, like, do I deserve this? And he was angry with me. And he goes, of course you deserve it. You've been doing this work for all these years. You've been, you know, working on your heart and your communication and your life. And, you know, but the way she makes me feel, it feels like this, like I've won the lottery. I said this to you also earlier. I said, the guy said to me, why are you getting married? You know, you're 53, your kids are grown, you know? And I said, well, please listen to this because it's so important. I said, when you're holding the winning lottery ticket in your hand, you stop looking for other tickets. So when I talk about making a man feel like you will make his life better, you will be a victory in his life. That's in the beginning, by the way. This is like the first thing where he's going to go, wow, my life's going to be better. That will get his attention. Then once you get to know each other, then you're both becoming a victory in each other's life. But he's not going to pay attention in the beginning if you're focused on what, you know, on your, in your profile, what you need and what you want and what you have to talk about the gift that you are in someone's life. And there are these 13 victories men look for. I've boiled it down to 13 because you want to catch his attention. You have to catch the attention in the beginning. And then, of course, things become, you know, more mutual. But the trick of dating, I think, in the beginning is being able to inspire a partner to see that you're going to make his life better. Another thing, men don't go out looking for commitment. That's not a word that means a lot to most men in terms of dating, okay? Men, unless they want to have a child and start a family, men want devotion. Men want somebody devoted to them, and they want to be devoted to somebody who will appreciate their heroic efforts. You know, appreciation is so important. Commitment is a very important word to women. It's not that big a word for men. It doesn't have an emotional pull, but devotion does. And devotion means that if he is going to use his life energies to serve you, everything from taking out the garbage to, you know, finding you resources for your business to making you feel safe and secure when you don't, whatever it is, it's all in the context of what I call heroic service. Now, Alison Armstrong is talking about this now, too. Men need to be a hero. And your appreciation does so much to make him motivated to be devoted to you and not to somebody else. And then if he feels you're devoted to him, that's emotional. So commitment's kind of a dry word for most men.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's really key that you said that, because I don't know that women are always really aware of that. And I really like the distinction of that you gave with devotion as opposed to commitment, and mm-hmm. that men are more inspired, generally speaking. Like we said, we don't make the totally blanket statements, but generally speaking, would be more inspired by the devotion side of things. And I also think what you said when you talked about a man serving a woman with his life energy, I think that's an interesting use of phrase. And it made me think that men are conscious, maybe in a way that sometimes women are not, in how they are expending their energy. And I think that they use, you know, they have more linear thinking, and they can sometimes see, you know, kind of the straightest, easiest path from point A to point B. It's, you know, just as a funny example, darling husband, you know, he leaves the cupboard doors open in our kitchen. And it's like, I've mentioned it to him sometimes, and he's like, well, I'm going to get right back in that cupboard in a few minutes. And, you know, I'm going around closing the cupboards behind him. But to him, that's like, you know, that's a waste of energy.
And it's true. You know the old saying, the man works from sun to sun, but a woman's work is never done?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one. And the other analogy I like to give is lions. You know, male lions are awake for about 2 hours a day. They sleep about 22 hours a day. Men conserve their energy. And it's kind of funny to us, but it actually has evolutionary roots. For 98% of our history as, you know, human beings, we were hunters, like really actually hunting for food every day. And you do conserve your energy when you have to hunt. And the other thing you do when you're hunting is you don't chatter. You don't talk a lot. So you know, and women throughout most of our history would be, you know, either gathering together or with the children, and they were always talking to stay in touch with each other. If they were, say, in the forest or in bushes or out in nature, you know, collecting stuff or staying safe. And so women have developed the ability to, what we call women's intuition, is actually a real, you know, physiological skill set that men don't have. It's a neurological skill set. And I've been doing so much research on the difference of brains. And it's so important to understand that we really are actually, our brains are different, and we actually function differently. And so men like to, quote unquote, cut to the chase. What's the bottom line? How can I fix this? How can I catch the mastodon? You know, it's like, how can I get this done and done? And it's a very sort of endemic masculine trait, and it's to be taken seriously, you know, and men have to learn that women don't operate the same way. And so we get frustrated. I call it the adorable pathetic. You know, we're each pathetic to each other because we're not as good at certain things. Like, for example, generally women don't have spatial sense the way that men do. Can't find their way around. Men have developed a spatial sense because we were hunting for most of our history. And women have a much more acute social sense. And men don't pick up little social signals, which is why you have to be really clear with men. Okay? And a grown-up man will really appreciate that. Can I give you a great example?
Yes, please.
I love it. So, I'll give you an example from my relationship. So when I met my fiance, I met her online, and it took me a couple of letters to get through to her. But she said to me two amazing things early on. She said a lot of amazing things. She said, I like you, after a few dates. She goes, I like you. I like who you are. And I have to ask you a question, because I called it for a date. And she said, before we go on another date, I have to ask you, is it in your playbook, in your life, to get married again and be in a relationship for the rest of your life? She goes, I'm not asking now, but is it something you want at some point? That was a very brave question for her to ask. And some guys might have thought it's too early, but I really admired her for putting it out there. And I said, you know, it is in my playbook, absolutely. Not in the next year or two. We've known each other 3.5 years. I said, not in the next year or two, because my kids have just gone off to college and I'm going to be traveling and sort of regrounding myself. But she was super clear on that and then let me know. So there's a movie called Her, H-E-R. I don't know if you saw it. Did you see it?
I haven't seen it, no.
Okay, it's great. And Joaquin Phoenix plays this guy, and there's a new kind of like Siri for, you know, the Apple phone, whatever. But it's an advanced intelligence that can learn. That's the difference. And what happens is he falls in love with it. It's on his computer, and he talks to it all the time. And the intelligence talks back to him and learns him as they go. And it turns out that everyone in the world is now falling in love with their computers, by the way. But but there's this amazing moment where he gets this program and he's told about it, like this intelligent learning, you know, computer program. And her first question is, would you like to know how I work? Now, I was in a plane when I heard that. I was flying from somewhere. And I jumped up in my seat and I wanted everyone in the plane to like stop playing solitaire or whatever they were doing and watch this movie. Because that is the best question a woman can ever ask a man. Hey, would you like to know how I work? Would you like to know what makes me feel loved? Would you like to know what makes me feel safe? You know? If a man says no, then you don't want to be with him. But men need clarity. We really, really do. We want to know how you work. We want to know what makes you happy. You know, I remember when I was married, and we were very young a long time ago. You know, now we're really good friends. But it was so frustrating because she would say, like, if you loved me, you would know what I was thinking. Now, again, we were
Yeah.
No. Tell us. Like, really be clear. And it's not so much an instruction of do this. It's like when he does something nice, or if you write something in his profile, or if you're on a date and he let's say he puts a hand on your lower back to cross a curb or going up a staircase, you can, and you like it, you can say to him, by the way, that makes me feel really safe and careful that you did that. Ding, 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 appreciation, victory. He's like, his boy mind is going, oh, I'm doing a good job. I can win this. I can win. You know, I'm going to win with this woman. I feel like a winner with her. You know, so appreciation really helps. And you can train men, the right man who's receptive, you can train him to do more of what you like by appreciating and admiring him deeper into the virtues that you admire about him. We're very responsive.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. You made me think of something here that I think might be another helpful example of this. So oft times when a woman is dating or getting serious with a man or is married to a man or in a relationship with a man, there are these expectations. We all come to relationships with expectations, right? And
yes.
Somehow we have, from our younger days, these fantasies that the right person is going to know intuitively everything that we want and need and will know exactly what we're thinking. And as we've already alluded to, that doesn't work very well.
Nope.
And so one of the things that I had the wisdom to do early on in my marriage, because I had my own long and winding journey to love and had to go through a lot of inner work and transformation to get to the point where I was really ready and able to attract this amazing love into my life, was that I wanted to help my husband to succeed. So when it came to things like anniversaries or Valentine's Day or my birthday or those kinds of things, instead of like just expecting him to intuitively know what I would like or how I would like to celebrate, when those things are approaching, I bring it up and have a conversation. And I think, why would a woman want to risk, you know, having a man forget her anniversary, heaven forbid, or disappoint her when she could just, in a very lovely, graceful way, let him know how he could be a big winner and succeed, and both of you have an amazing time. And so this has been really fun for me to experiment with this with my husband. And so we have these fantastic celebrations and holidays, and I get exactly the things that I most want. And he gets to feel like he's pleasing me and that he's won. And oftentimes it's almost like he feels like it was his idea when in fact I planted these seeds.
Well, that's
but
the
I
secret.
Just think this is just an example of, this is just an example of, you know, a way that women can help a man to succeed and to please her, and then both of you end up feeling great.
Which is kind of the idea.
Yeah, it is kind of the idea.
You know, so one of the ways of getting clear, I always ask women when I work with them, or men, you know, when we talk about dating, I ask them, what do you want to feel in your relationship? What should it feel like to you? Right? Everyone's thinking they're going shopping. They have this big shopping list of, I want this quality and this quality, and he's got to do this, and he's got to look like this. How do you want to feel? Like, what are the most important feelings you want to have? You know, so for my partner, for her, it was very clear. She was also very clear in the beginning. She goes, it's very important to me that I don't want to be hurt. She goes, I want you to keep in mind, I've been very hurt. She was very hurt in her last relationship, in her marriage. And she goes, I really don't want to be hurt, so I want you to know that up front. I'm like, okay, good to know. Thank you. And then what's important to you? She wants to feel free, to be playful and silly, which is great because I am very playful and silly. I actually showed up at her door yesterday in a full-body panda outfit unexpectedly. Just for fun. But like, for example, and this is a great example, I met a woman once online many years ago, and she seemed amazing, and she was beautiful and smart and all this stuff, and she was in France, and we met online, and we met on Skype, and it seemed to go well, and she was a yacht broker in Saint-Tropez, and she goes, listen, I'm a yacht broker, why don't you come over, we can, you know, stay on a yacht. I'm like, okay, you know, why would I say no? And I went, and you know, when I was coming out of the gate, I kind of like made Mickey Mouse ears, kind of waved to her as I was getting my bag, you know, something playful. And she was like, why did you do that? That's so not masculine. I'm like, oh, and it was very bad. The whole thing was very bad. I left the next day, and did the tour of, Provence, by myself without her that I had planned. So, but she wasn't a playful person. She was much more stuck up. She was very stuck up around, you know, proper ways of behaving with waiters, and everything was, it was really horrible. So it's not that she's a bad person, but we had very different modes of being. Like, playfulness was very important to my fiance. It's very important to me. So that's a high value. I want to feel free to be playful. She wanted to feel free to be playful. You might want to feel safe. You might want to feel heard. You might want to feel, independent, depending on who you are. Everyone's different. So think about what you want to feel in a relationship, not just the qualities, you know, of the person you're trying to attract. Okay? What are the feelings every day? How do you want to feel during the day? And then communicate that as you start dating and get to know each other. You know, set, like, for example, say, I love it when it makes me, and this is how to do it. Remember, appreciation and admiration. I feel really cherished when you call me in the middle of the day just to check in and tell me how things are going. Or it makes me feel so connected to you. It makes me want to just come home and make love to you at the end of the day. You add a reward, right? So men, that's how we process information. Oh, I'm doing a good job, and I'm going to get a reward. I'll keep doing this thing. So it's very important to speak to that man's linear mind that you were talking about and appreciate and reward him for what you like about him that makes you feel the way you want to feel.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's a skill that doesn't always come intuitively and that we can learn. And I know you have some resources for that, which we're going to be talking about in a few minutes, to help women with this, because it's not something that always comes naturally, and yet it is something that we can improve upon and we can learn, right?
It's just a skill set, like learning tennis or learning, you know, WordPress or learning, you know, anything. It's just skill set. These are skill sets that we shouldn't feel ashamed that we don't have them, because I didn't have them, you know, and I went on this journey of learning from everyone I could in the world and attending a million workshops and reading every book I could find to figure out how this works, because I really wanted to have a love relationship. And yeah, so it's just skills. You just learn. It's like we're doing here.
Right. Right. So you've alluded to some of this already, but what do you think are some of the biggest mistakes that women make in understanding how men actually choose a life partner? So the one thing you mentioned already that stands out is that the commitment thing, that may not be the most inspiring way to for a man to think. That may not be the direction he's thinking in. But what else do you think are some of the biggest mistakes women make in understanding how men choose their life partner?
Right. It's been my experience that men who have choice, men who, you know, who really have, you know, are good guys, they have a job, they're, you know, they got their life together, they're kind, they're good, and who have choice, they tend to, I'll now put myself into that category now that I'm there, we tend to back into commitment. We tend to wake up one day and go, oh my God, my life is so much better with this person than it would be without this person. And it's not, we don't go out saying, I'm going to find a commitment, right? We just day by day going, wow, my life feels really good. And it's sort of, and I've seen this happen over and over, and it happened to me. It just dawned on me in one moment, and it's kind of the risk of, you know, sounding too romantic. It was an amazing moment. It was totally unexpected. We were just walking down the street in Santa Monica and passed a dress shop, and I said, oh my God, that's the most beautiful dress I've ever seen. I'd love to see that on you. And we went in, and we were just going to the farmer's market on a Sunday morning, you know, just on a sweat. And she walked out of the dressing room, and I was on my phone or whatever, you know, texting. And I looked up, and just, it was like one of those lightning moments, and just tears started streaming down my face. And It was that moment of, I know, right? It's very romantic.
Oh, you're making the women on this call swoon, I know.
because what she had been doing for the last 3 years, you know, she had been growing herself. She had been an amazing partner. She was so thoughtful. You know, when my mother found out, you know, when I found out that my mother's heater didn't work in her house in upstate New York, you know, she was on Amazon and sent her room heaters to balance out the gas heaters to make sure she had heat. Like, she's thoughtful. She made my life better. She made me proud to be with her. And so it wasn't like she didn't do anything in that moment, but it just hit me. Oh my God, I'm with a regal human being, you know, and I better lock this shit down. Excuse my language. Like, it's not going to get better than this, you know, and so that's how, and, you know, that's your work. Men have their work to do. Your work is to be so happy with who you are, making yourself happy, doing the things that give you joy. Your joy is an aphrodisiac for us. We want to be around your feminine joy. We want you happy in your body. We want you happy in how you love and how you live. And we want to feel like, wow, you're going to be thoughtful in ways that I didn't think of. And you're just going to make my life a happier place. And then it kind of strikes us like lightning one day. Like, oh gosh, I'm really in love with this person. And that's kind of how it happened. And it tends to happen for guys, as I have found.
Yeah, so backing into love, and oh, that story you told about your fiance and her walking out in that dress was so incredibly moving.
God, my God, what a dress, too. I have it on my Facebook page. Yeah, it was amazing. It happens to be a very beautiful dress.
I really appreciate, Adam, also what you're saying about a woman creating an amazing life for herself and radiating that happiness and that joy. And I think that's a thing that sometimes women don't recognize is so incredibly magnetic and attractive, because if we're talking about a man being able to succeed or being able to win or being able to know that he can be successful with a woman, he's already like halfway there if a woman's already happy with her life, right? He doesn't have as big of a leap to make to make her happy or to feel like he can make her happy, right?
Right. And the thing is, if you're not happy with your life, you're going to attract the wrong kind of guy. You're going to attract the guy who's like, oh, I'm going to fix her. You know, I'm going to be her savior. And then now your power balance is all off. And your relationship is not built on two adults leaning together. It's someone leaning on someone else. And it's not good. It almost always goes bad. And something I love to remind women about, you know, I wrote movies for years. So I love the language of movies. And you'll notice in many movies, everybody watch from now on, when a man falls in love with a woman, when he sees a woman and falls for her, right? In that first moment, in a movie moment, she's always either smiling or beautifying something, like maybe doing her art, like in the movie The Player, or she's helping someone. She's is an expression of love. So it's always an expression of love or joy. That's men fall in love with women's radiance, with their love and their joy. Because men, remember what I said about status earlier on?
Yeah.
And it's something the women may not know. But men's internal life is kind of dry because the way we've evolved, it's am I winning, am I losing? Am I winning, am I losing? And your internal mind is, do I feel safe and cherished? Do I not feel safe and cherished? And there's good reasons for that evolutionarily. And so the winning-losing thing is very useful at work, but it's a very dry place. And you, the feminine, you know, fill us with joy and life and movement and pleasure. And you're our escape from that status need. Am I winning? Am I losing? You know, did I make enough sales? Is my boss mad at me? Do my partners, are they disappointed in me? And do my sons admire me enough? You know, that's what's going on in our head almost constantly, even if it's subconsciously. And your joy and your radiance and your dance and like all that beautiful, lovely, luscious, feminine joy, you know, is balm for our life. And I don't think women know that enough.
Yeah. Yeah,
now,
I'm so...
I just want to be really careful. I'm not saying that you can't be a full human being and be sad. And you know, I'm not saying that at all. I'm talking about the beginning. Like, that's what's gonna call us up. Okay, obviously we all get sad. We all have moods. That's okay.
Yeah, there has to be that safety for authenticity in a relationship. And yes, you're right to make that distinction. This is what's going to be magnetizing and attractive and draw the right kind of man in. Plus, let's face it, if you're living an amazing life, you're going to be much more joyful in the meantime, right? So there's no downside to this.
No, there's no, yeah, right. No, I always say, people say, wait, I have to be joyful to find the right partner. I'm like, well, that's a bonus. The good part is you actually get to have a wonderful life.
Right. Right. So, Adam, do you mind if I ask you a personal question?
Sure. I'll open book.
So I think some of the women on the call might be thinking to themselves, okay, so here's this man, Adam Gilad, who's been single for all these years, and now he's engaged to this amazing woman who you've described to us in part. And you've said some of the things, you've mentioned some of the things that made her stand out or that made her appeal to you or that made her attractive to you. But, you know, it's like, I know for women, we're always trying to figure this out. So we've talked about the joyful, happy thing. We've talked about, but it's like, I know women are saying, well, you know, why after all these years was it this woman that finally, you know, finally was the one that drew him into a relationship? Because, you know, you were single for a number of years. And
yes.
I think there's probably, that's a question that might be going through the minds of some of these women.
Great.
So
that's
a personal
question,
if you don't mind answering.
It's a great question. Because I want to say, I loved being single. You know, I really had fun. You know, and I you know, the marriage was kind of tough on me in many ways. And once I figured out dating, you know, how to find amazing women, there's lots of amazing women, and I really enjoyed meeting them. And, you know, I traveled a lot, and I had amazing experiences, and there was no lack in my heart, you know, except sometimes, you know, when you're alone. So what made her different? It's a great question, because she wasn't what I expected. Nobody expected me to stay with her. On the surface, it didn't make sense, because I thought, I'm going to marry, you know, and I'm going to marry, like, this really spiritual yoga teacher, you know, who has a psychology degree and it's really deep, you know. And in fact, the two women I met before her were exactly those things.
Mm-hmm.
And it did not work out. It did not work out for very real reasons, partly because they were wonderful, but they weren't the right woman for me and I wasn't the right man for them. She, it turns out, happens to be the right woman for me. So let's go through it. And again, everyone's unique. Right? Everyone has their own unique sort of Lego piece that someone else fits. Okay, number one, I value, and this is really important, I value her wisdom. I value her, what she brings to the table that I'm not so good at. I tend to be too trusting. I tend to see the good in everybody. She has a really good eye for people, and she has a very high level of integrity. And so if people you know, aren't trustworthy, she can spot it before me. And I actually value that. You were talking about a woman who helps make your life successful. She has handled her own pain in her life. She had a very difficult childhood, I can't go into details, but, you know, not a happy, healthy, supportive environment all the time. She had a very nasty divorce with somebody who just took revenge on her in not nice ways. So she had trouble, but she doesn't carry it. She did her work. She went to therapy. She got coaching. And she brings herself to the moment with a lot of joy. That's good. So she's always a pleasure to be with, you know, and she's so encouraging of other people. Another thing, remember I said that we fall in love with your ability to love? You know, it's very sexy to us. She is a Harvard-trained behavior specialist, and she specializes in children's behavior, particularly autism and other things. And I watch her, and I see how the family she works with just adore her, because what she does is she pours love out on these children. I mean, I call her the fountain, La Fontana, because she's a fountain of love. She pours love out. And to me personally, that is the most attractive thing in a woman possible. Because, you know, I'm a guy, I'm in my head, I'm very loving, but I stand in awe of the joy and love that she pours on these children who love her. Like, they're in their kids you worked with when they were three, who are now in their 20s, still love her, you know? And I admire that about her, and it's not something I do naturally, so it's a nice compliment to my life. I also liked her clarity. I mentioned one of the clarity things that she said to me early. She also said something else, and this was a really good one. Ready for this one? This is the thing that really got my attention. So we had been dating a few weeks, maybe a month or so, a month and a half. And she said to me, you know what? She goes, I really like you. You've got my attention, right? And she said, I've decided that I'm taking my profile down. I don't want to date anyone else. I really want to get to know you. And here comes the magic part. Ready? She goes, and you're free to do whatever you want. And I think my jaw hit the floor, because I know enough to know those are magic words to a man, because she wasn't insisting that I do anything. She respected me enough and my process enough to allow me my independence. She was clear about what she wanted to do. She was a grown-up, and she took responsibility for herself and let me make my responsible decision for myself. That was a huge turn-on, because...
Yeah,
I felt, wow, this is someone who's very mature, you know, and that was important to me. That was a big one. What else? And we have fun together. You know, it's important for me to have fun and laugh, and that's a big part of our relationship. We like that, you know. We're probably sillier than most people. We're just like that. We both have a sort of childlike enjoyment of being happy. And that's just unique to us. You know, not everyone's like that. Some people... are very social, like some people are incredibly socially motivated to, you know, do great works of charity and our social justice. And that's fantastic. And then if you meet someone who's also motivated that way, you're a great pair together, right? So you have to look for what makes you happy, not what the ideal man is, but again, how do you want to feel in a relationship? What else? Also, I like the fact that this is what I tell women, it's in my book, to look for is a man who's interested in growth, who's curious about male-female dynamics, who's curious about how to make a happy relationship. She could have, you know, talked my ear off about all the things that were wrong with her ex-husband, but instead what she did was talk about what the kind of life she wants to create, and she's committed to creating now. And that's sexy. You know, she didn't harp on the past. She said, I've made these are the mistakes I've made. This is the kind of relationship I want to have, and this is how I want to communicate. And she knew, you know, she had done her work, and that's very appealing. She's curious and interested and committed to having a great love relationship, and actively, not just in theory. So she'll bring stuff up, and we can have conversations about, you know, the life we want to create. So that's exciting, because then it's a dynamic mutual growth process. And I think that's very sexy. And the worst thing, and this is a big thing for men, men don't want to feel trapped. Men don't want to feel like they're stuck. They want to feel like there's an open road ahead of you. So if you can keep that sense of, we're in this together, I really love you, I like you, we're going to keep growing together, we're going to keep talking, and it's an open road, men love the sense of freedom, you know, and freedom doesn't mean not in a commitment, it means free to keep moving forward, not feeling stuck. So if you're curious about relationship, that's one of the victories men look for. And I mentioned, remember I mentioned the 13 victories?
Yeah.
So one of the victories is I will win with this woman because she likes men. Very important to say, by the way. Say your profile. I love men. Not just men. I particularly love men who, and that's when you start laying in. I give lots of examples in my book of ways to talk about character that men will respond to. They'll feel that victory. I like men who are like, you know, who have these characteristics. So we matched. She was very clear about what she wanted. And she still tells me 3.5 years later, because I'll look at her sometimes and she'll say, I love you. And I'll look at her and she goes, all right, here's why I love you. I'll say, why do you love me so much? What did I do? I was just sitting here, you know? And she'll say, you're thoughtful, you're funny, you're sensitive, you're kind, you're a good father. And she'll run down the list. Now, I'm not a big fan of lists, but she kind of has to reassure me sometimes. And she's very clear about the qualities that she likes in a man. And we happen to match. So that's why I call it the right man online. Because you have to call out the person who's right for you. And you call it the right guy. It's perfect.
Yeah, and what stood out to me there is she was clear and specific about things. It's not just this general blah, 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 you're nice. She was speaking about some very specific things that she admires about you and your character and who you are.
Yes. Yeah, we fit together. We fit. So you have to look to find someone that fits. And anything that doesn't fit, you work out. You shift around and find ways to accommodate each other.
Yeah.
Yes, it's working. So far,
yeah,
so good.
That's amazing. So, Adam, before we wrap up today, I just want to ask you one last question. So, for women who have been out there, been beat up a little bit, had their
sure.
heart shot through the trees a few times, what can you give as kind of a parting word of encouragement for these women and something to just kind of give them hope?
Number one, there's a lot of good men out there. There really are. They come to my events. They're on my list. They write to me. You've got to give guys a chance to get past that initial awkwardness. Even my fiance said, initially she goes, yeah, you had the whole Rico Suave thing. You came in and, it took about half an hour for me to calm down where she could start actually seeing who I was. So, guys might feel awkward. They might feel a lot, they might feel bad. They've been beat up too. And so we come with a little bit of armor and a little bit of shame and, be patient with each other and be compassionate. And if you call in the right man by using these techniques by character instead of characteristics, then you've got good raw material to work with. So have compassion. If you can make a man feel accepted, that's a big step, because masculine shame is a huge issue. Brené Brown, we could talk about this for hours. It's something that's been unappreciated until very recently, how much shame men carry over their sense of having failed in life in all the different ways. So compassion is huge, but filtering, that's the biggest word, filtering early on so that the right kind of men come into your world. Then you can, as one of my coaches said, love them into their greatness. And he can
beautiful.
Do the same for you. Yeah, and he can love you into your full greatness. That's a beautiful phrase. I love my coaches.
Yeah, love them into their greatness. And that really has been kind of a theme for this conversation. And I've really enjoyed it, Adam. Thank you so much for being so generous with your wisdom.
And you're so
great. It's been a pleasure to have you. And I just want to also thank each of you for being here with us today and invite you to consider implementing the ideas that resonate with you from the interview. And so Adam and I are both sending you lots of love, many blessings, and wishing you happiness as you get ready for your right guy. Bye-bye for now.